this week on a special NHRA Today. It's the All-Star Weekend for sportsmen racing in Columbus, Ohio. And we salute an NHRA racer voted American Motorsports Driver of the Year. It's all in the next half hour from National Trail Raceway. When we're done, you'll know all about the 1996 Federal-Mogul All-Star Race. It's next on NHRA Today.
NHRA Today is brought to you by Mopar, Chrysler Corporation Parts, and the Chrysler Plymouth, Dodge, Jeep, and Eagle dealers who sell and install them. And by Castrol Syntec Blend, added protection for severe driving conditions.
It is June 9th, 1996, and time for the Federal Mogul All-Star Competition. Through the magic of videotape, we interrupt your otherwise drab off-season with some serious NHRA drag racing. I'm Steve Evans, and I think you're going to like the next half hour. Now, the Federal Mogul program is about more than individual honors. There's also very strong team competition among NHRA's seven divisions. Last year, Frank Monzo, well, he aced him for the Northeast Division. They took the title. How does it set up for 96? Well, here's Bob Fry to tell us.
Well, the Federal Mogul All-Star program really is the best gathering of the season for the racers in the sportsman division. We got racers from all over the country in all seven divisions. Let's meet them right now, starting with Division One, who just happens to be your defending champions.
And they come from the Northeast. States like Maryland, New York, and Pennsylvania, even Canada. There are big names like Biondo, Boyd, Bastianelli, and the ace, Frank Manzo. They are the best of the best, and they're under the direction of Greg Exicalis. Division 2 features drivers from the southeastern part of the country, and like their Division 1 counterparts, the Dixie Rebels have some big names, too. How about Ed Richardson, Grant Lewis, Tony Bartone, perfect on the year so far in Funny Car, and Winston champ Jay Payne. Bill Holt heads up the Rebel racers from the southeast with honorary captain Patty Renner. The North Central Division has nowhere else to go this year but up. Last year's last place finisher has no blockers, just heads up racers who will use names like Matthews, Falk, Visner, Parsons, Rashid, Arnold, Gottschalk, and Baird to try to sneak out of Columbus with a win. Jay Hollinger and honorary captain Kathleen Schmaltz provide direction for Division 3. Last year's champs would love to fire the guns again this year in Columbus, and they've got the good guys to do it. Edmund Richardson will block in Super Comp, and he's not the only big gun from the South Central Division. The rest of the Bullet Boys include Kahutek, Phillips, Emmons, Merle, Bo Nickens, Todd Simpson, and Darrell Russell. Craig Hutchinson provides the sights for Division 4.
Division 4 is number one.
Next up, the High and Mighty Boys from Division 5. The West Central region will employ no blockers, but plenty of horses. Gary Sinnott, Bradley Grant, Vern Moats, and David Wells, just a few of the names, led by Charlie Harmon and John Battle, the honorary captain.
We're going to get him! We're going to get him!
Last year, the Land of the Leaders finished fourth. This year, Division 6 hopes to live up to its name. But it will be tough without a driver in both comp and alcohol dragster. The points must come from other drivers like Eric Waldo and Bucky Austin, who lead the way for division director Gordy Hawthorne. Last but not least, we present the Pacific Division. Last year, the Magnificent Seven finished third. This season, Chuck Rayburn, Dennis Taylor, and Gary Selzy lead the way as director Ned Walliser will keep them primed and ready to go here in Columbus.
So there they are, the seven divisions competing for the Federal Mogul Sportsman All-Star Competition. We started out with number one, the defending champ, wound up with Division 7. Ironically enough, they've never won this thing, but they're out to change all that here today.
Thanks, Bob. The chase for number one starts next with Super Street and Super Gas. But first, here's this week's Simpson Brain Teaser. From Bowling Green to Columbus, this is the 12th time the sportsmen have contested the All-Star Weekend. Let's go racing. Here's Bob Fry.
Thanks, Steve. The first of eight classes to hit the strip is Super Street. And a look at the ladder finds Division 7's Brian Griffey at the top of the All-Star heap in his 70 Charger. Craig Abbott, Joe Ricky Weldon, Kelly Schilling, and Rudy Matthews round out the top five. Now the top four all moved on to round two, except for Griffey. Up against Division III's Rudy Matthews, who had distributor problems in qualifying, Griffey was no match for the 5.06 reaction time and 10.904 of Matthews. Number one is out of here. In the next round, Matthews came up against Division II's Joe Ricky Weldon. 1/100th of a second advantage at the line was not enough to beat the rude dog, who made up the difference and took the win by 3,000. The final round found Matthews up against Division V's Kelly Schilling, who broke out of the previous round but still took the win. Again, it was a breakout win, but this time for Matthews. Rudy's 10.894 was 1,000th of a second better and was good enough for the Federal Mogul Super Street win.
Great for Division III and real good for me. This will help our vacation. This is our 25th wedding anniversary coming up, and we're going to Hawaii, and this will really help.
How about that? Well, don't spend that money all in one place.
We'll have a good time, I guarantee you.
And now, Red Wing Shoes wants to take a moment to tell you who's hot in the world of drag racing. The season's accomplishments of six-time Funny Car champ John Force have not gone unnoticed by top motorsports journalists across the country. Last Monday in Indianapolis, John was named the Driver of the Year, marking the first time since his prestigious award's inception in 1967 that a drag racer has ever been honored.
I got kind of a game plan in my life. I'm going to restructure my deal. And now, with this award, I'm going to have a whole new game plan. It's like, I always kind of thought, like, when you won an award like this, I kind of retired you. But I'm going to turn this whole deal around, and I'm going to go, I'm going to start my life today at 47. So, yeah, I'm starting to feel kind of old, right?
Congratulations to John Ford. And be sure to tune in next week when Red Wing Shoes will once again tell you who's hot in the world of drag racing.
Now we move on to Super Gas, where Rodney Scarlett from Division 7 was the only driver in the top four to lose in the first round. Scarlett lost to defending Winston champ and Division 5 rep Ben Raymond. In the semis, Raymond ran up against the confused Frank Kohutek. Frank was unable to dial in due to the conditions all weekend long, but he got a big break as the champ's 68 Camaro broke, allowing Frank a solo shot down the track. A frustrating 9.95, but good enough for the finals. On the other side, it was number one qualifier Tim Sheehan of Division I up against third qualifier Robert Guido out of Division II. While Sheehan's reaction time was quicker, it wasn't good enough as Guido's 9.941 stopped Sheehan's run with a 9.947. The final held a day later was a great one. The two left the starting line together, but as they approached the 1,100-foot mark, Kohutek caught him. 9.97 again, nowhere close to the dial. Frank held on for the win by 6/1000ths of a second.
Well, this is great. This really is. I don't know. I've always wanted to come here and talk to you, Bob, and now I got a chance. I don't know what to say. I'd like to thank my car owner, Donnie Burnside, for sticking behind me. And, man, this is a great race. I appreciate it, Bob.
Coming up, Super Comp and Stock as the Federal Mogul All-Star Weekend continues. We're back at National Trail Raceway for the rain-soaked Federal Mogul All-Star Competition. Here's Bob with the Super Comp story.
A look at Super Comp's ladder, and you might think that Tommy Phillips, the number eight man from Division IV, was down on his luck. Speaking of luck, imagine for a second that you're on your way to your first All-Star race and you get word that your home's been flooded. That's exactly what happened to the number four man, Gary Stinnett from Kansas. 4 inches of rain in 1 hour not only hit the home, but destroyed all of his racing mementos. After encouragement to race on, it was the battle of broken hearts as Stinnett faced Phillips in round one. Using a 1,400th advantage of the line, Stinnett got to the quarter-mile mark first, even though Phillips was closer to the dial. Gary's hole shot win meant he would next face Ed Richardson. Using a borrowed engine, Richardson missed the setup on the throttle stop, and in a double breakout, Stinnett was closer to the dial, his 87 better than Ed's 83. In the finals, it was again a pair of dragsters, Stinnett against the Division I champ, the Delaware Destroyer, Danny Bastianelli. Stinnett had the better light as the two came to the top. Gary backpedaled the Wendy's car, nailed the dial in with an 8.906, good enough to beat Bastianelli's closing 8.92. Division 5 had its first Federal Mogul champion.
Oh, man, I got down there. I was a little fast, and he's coming on me, and I had to back into him a little bit. That was close. I was more nervous for this than I was in the final at Indy. This just has a lot of prestige to it. And thank the Lord, we got the money. We can go home and start rebuilding our house.
Great job. Congratulations, Gary.
Kestrel presents the GTX Pipeline, the latest news from the world of drag racing.
Okay, folks, here it is. The highlights of the Federal Mogul title right sponsorship program of all NHRA sportsman competition in 1997. The point structure and scoring system will not change, but the award and bonus packages will, with at least a 50% increase across the board. The divisional races will be known as NHRA Federal Mogul Drag Racing Series events, and the alcohol classes will be called Federal Mogul Dragsters and Funny Cars. National championship bonuses will increase 78%, or nearly $40,000 per division, with awards going to first through third. Television coverage has also expanded, and all other Federal Mogul Drag Racing programs, such as the All-Star Race, the 900 programs, and the contingency awards will remain the same. But hey, with all that money up for grabs, you're gonna go tune up your hot rod.
The Grade 8 and Stock Eliminator had some big names in it. Defending Winston champ Chuck Rayburn, defending All-Star champion Marianne Method, Bradley Grant and Gary Glazner were the top four in qualifying. Heading into the semis, only Method, a blocker, couldn't continue. She fouled out against the number six qualifier, Bruce Parsons. That meant that Parsons from Division III would face Division VII's Chuck Rayburn with a handicap lead in the semis. But a red light by Bruce in the far lane meant that Rayburn waltzed into the finals. In the other semifinal race, Gary Glazner of Division II faced off against Division V's Bradley Grant. And although Glazner's 551 light was better than the 611 of Grant, Gary didn't have the power. His 1134, 8,000ths off the dial, fell to Bradley's perfect 1120. It was 5-3 in the final as Grant got the handicap jump in the far lane. As they came topside, it was still Grant who appeared to win. But the timing slip says it all. Bradley's 11-16, 300's too quick, and Rayburn over by 100th gave him the win. Pretty good for a guy whose elbow accident almost cost him the season.
I didn't think I'd be here either. I came pretty close not being here. But this is just something, you know, that it only happens to most stock eliminator guys once or twice the whole career they race. And to win it, and after last year losing by 1/100 of a second to Marianne Method, and then to be in it, that was really a close race just now, man.
There's the Winston champ, the world champ, and one pretty lucky guy.
Up next, it's more sportsman racing as the super stock and comp drivers are now in the staging lane. Welcome back to the Federal Mogul All-Star Sportsman Weekend. Two more champions are crowned, starting with super stock and Bob Fry.
When it comes to qualifying, no number one guy has put it all together in eliminations to take the win. That means Division VI's Jeff Lane could provide a couple of firsts. First number one qualifier to win, and his first Federal Mogul All-Star title. Would he get it? Let's find out. In the opening round, the Seattle driver went up against Division V's Tom Meyer. The handicap start for Meyer made it look like the 66 Chevy had the advantage. Lane not only made up the distance, he was closer to the dial-in, and he moved on to face defending Winston champ Mike Say in the semis. Again, at the start, it appears the advantage goes to Division II's Say. But Say, hey, the 497 light by the champ allows Lane to motor on to the win and a chance at the title. In the far lane, Jeff moved in against his Division IV rival, Albie Merle, the number 8 qualifier, who had disposed of Frank Roski and Peter Biondo to make the championship round. And in one of the more interesting races, a chunk of mud fell from Lane's machine under the right rear tire. Jeff kept control, but the slip slowed him to a 985 on a 77 dial-in. Not to worry, Merle broke out, giving Division VI its first champion.
We spun the tires there on that last pass, and so I'm thinking I was a little bit slow, and he was out in front of me a little bit, so I think the only way we could have won is if he broke out. That's my guess.
It's going to make that drive or tow or fly back home a lot nicer, isn't it?
It's going to make it a long flight, easy flight home. Grumpy's, that was our last race with our car. We just sold the car, and they're delivered on the way home, and we're starting with a new one next week in Yakima.
A little happy for this weekend, huh, Jeff?
Very happy. Thank you very much.
That's one happy driver from the fifth different division to win in the five events held so far. Of course, you already know what division picked up the team title if you read National Dragster. If you don't, there's no better New Year's gift you can give yourself. All you have to do is join NHRA. And talk about a great deal. For $57, you get 48 issues of National Dragster, a pin, a patch, a decal, and a rule book, a lot of other neat stuff. And if you join right now by calling the number on your screen, you can get your choice of the Diamond Fee Video Drag Racing 95 or the good-looking NHRA membership T-shirt. Your choice. Just call now. Or better yet, do it yourself on your personal computer. Same deal.
With only seven drivers making the call in comp, that meant the lucky guy that qualified number one would get a bye run and automatically start in the semis. And that honor went to Division II blocker Rick Horde. Jerry Arnold got by Division II's Grant Lois, and that made that half of the semifinals. The the bottom half of the ladder, Kevin Robbs stole a win against Tom Snyder. Bo Nickens handled Division 7's Jeff Krug. Semifinal number one put Division 3's Arnold up against the supercharged Corvette of Ford. And although Arnold's teammate jetting and ignition changes between rounds, it didn't make any difference as Horde bumps the gas and fouls out, allowing Arnold to drive down the quarter mile ticket in hand for the finals. Next, it was Nickens' dragster against the 92 Camaro of Kevin Robb. Nickens' 505 light was not as good as the 504 cut by Robb. But the end result's all that matters, and that found Nickens with the advantage, and he was heading to the final. Now, Bo was great on the line in the semis, but he slowed to a 5.74 reaction time in the finals. That gave Jerry Arnold the advantage he needed to take his 32 Phantom to the winner's circle.
That's the biggest win of my life, Bob. Wow, I can't believe it. I told you I'd be ready.
Big win for you, but that puts your division now in the lead.
All right, good for us. All right, I knew Rudy won in Super Street. Yep, that's great.
Beating a Nickens guy doesn't make it any tougher to take, huh?
Guys, man, they're good guys. They're good racers, you know. And I told David yesterday I wish him the best in pro stock, and I'd be rooting for him, you know, because, I mean, that's the ideal thing for a comp guy to move to pro stock. But, hey, what's our day today? Wow.
Division 3 has a slight lead, but Divisions 1, 2, and 5 are right on their tails. The alcohol finals are next.
Promotional consideration provided for and a fee paid by this special offer from Diamond P.
NHRA Drag Racing 1996, a year packed with excitement and emotion, a year that you should remember. To order, just dial 1-800 number on your screen. You can relive King Kenny Bernstein's 318-mile-per-hour run, John Force capturing his unprecedented 6th Winston Drag Racing Championship, Jim Yates marching to his first Pro Stock Championship, and Angel Sealy pounded her Pro Stock bike to a new national record. Drag Racing 96. Order it now.
It's time to settle the score on the Federal Mogul team competition, courtesy of the alcohol funny cars and Bob Fry.
With the 33-round win streak heading into Columbus, the only surprise for Tony Bartone was that he wasn't the number one qualifier. That honor belonged to Todd Simpson as two holes were left open, giving the winner of the Simpson-Manzo battle a free ride into the final. Reaction advantage went to Simpson by 21 hundredths, and although Todd held the lead most of the race, Manzo made a top-end charge and stopped Simpson 595 to a 598.
I don't really care who I run. Did I just run another 595? So we're staying consistent, we're not shaking. Who cares if we're a little bit behind in the final? A final, anything can happen.
To find Tony Bartone's last defeat, you have to go way back to September of 95. 9 straight races and looking for a 10th, Bartone squared off against Division 3's Bob Gottschalk. Gottschalk got the jump as Bartone was all over the track, but a broken blower belt slowed Bob and allowed Tony to steal the win. In the semis, Bartone faced Division 7's Dennis Taylor. This time, no question about it, Bartone not only won the war at the line, but the battle at the finish. Down by more than 10th to Tony heading into the final, Manzo had to step it up. Thought he went just a little too far, and that allowed Bartone to extend his streak to 36 round wins with a Federal Mogul Championship. It also avenged last year's loss to Manzo at the All-Star event.
We struggled a little bit here in the beginning with the qualifying. The last lap we got it picked up, and we made 2 consistent laps. We're happy to win, and I don't know what more to say.
Were you thinking about last year's final?
No, not at all. You know, I try to concentrate on the job at hand and just focus myself on the car and not think about any of the other things that aren't going to help me win a race.
Tony Bartone, big win, and in one word, he would say it was
more than unbelievable.
And that leaves us with the top alcohol dragster with the team title still up for grabs. Again, 2 cars failed to make the show, and that meant that either number one qualifier, Richard Boyd of Division 1, or Gary Selzy from Division 7 would go straight into the finals. When the tree went green, Selzy took off with a huge 4,500 advantage over Boyd. Somewhere down the track, Selzy slowed, and a gift to Boyd as Peabody ran a subpar 595, but still, he's gone to the finals.
We're happy to be here. The XI team has been struggling with breakage for the last couple of meets. And right now we're struggling a little bit with tire shake, but we're very happy to be here.
One of the best races of the weekend came courtesy of Division 3's Chuck Baird and Division 2's Jay Payne. Both divisions still in the title chase, both guys titans in the class. Payne's 410 light wasn't good enough to stop the top end charge of Baird. Chuck gets the win by 4 hundredths.
Next up for the wild side car was Division 5's David Wells. Again, a crucial team matchup. Chuck's 4:26 reaction time more than a tenth quicker than Wells. Plain Vanilla is out of here as Chucky Baird heads to the finals against Peabody Boyd. The two quickest cars all weekend, Baird took the far lane against the X-Side machine of Boyd. It figured to be a close race. Boyd lit the tires and tried to backpedal, and Baird was all over the place, but he went the distance for the win that gave Division 3 the team title.
It was a pretty wild ride. It shook and spun and went for the wall two or three times. And I know it tore a lot of stuff up, but I guess we won. That's all that matters.
Shook a couple times, went for the wall, and let me think, you never once thought about lifting.
No way. We're going to the other end.
And that assault on the other end means Chuck Baird is this week's Mopar performer for not only winning Alcohol Dragster, but also clinching the win for Division 3 on their home court. Our congratulations to Chuck Baird, Jay Hullinger, and the rest of the Division 3 races on their win in the team competition. With three individual champions and 11 total round wins, they lead the way over Divisions 5, 1, and 2. Well, that's the story from Columbus. Now be sure to join us again next week when the junior dragsters will take center stage. For Bob Fry, I'm Steve Evans. We'll see you then here on TNN.
NHRA Today has been brought to you by Pep Boys, 26,000 items.